Macmillan Audio presents Treeborne, a novel by Caleb Johnson, read for you by Courtney Patterson. For the women who raised me up in stories, Deborah Johnson and Celia Sampley. What the self is tangles itself knottily with what his people were and what they came out of. John Graves, Goodbye to a River. Behold, that which I have built I will break down, and that which I have planted will I pluck up. Even this whole land. Jeremiah 45:4. Treeborne. Stories we tell. Today. The water was coming, but Janie Treeborne would not leave. She'd lived alone in this house perched on the edge of a roadside peach orchard in Alberta, Alabama, ever since Lee Malone sold it to her. Sold, maybe not the right word for the price she paid, the price he would take. But it was hers, and she would not leave. Rather, the water take her, too. She'd been telling her visitor exactly how she came to own the house, which once was Lee's office, and before that, his boyhood home. A complicated matter. To tell how this house and the surrounding property became hers, she needed to tell how it became Lee's, and to do that, she needed to first tell about a man named Mr. Prince.
See, back then, folks thought Mr. Prince wasn't but a rumor and a last name, she continued. But he was real. Lived in one of them mansions down on the river. Anyhow, Lee started working at the peach pit not long after the storm. Worked here for years. Then one day Mr. Prince carried him to lunch out at Woodrow's. The hills would have been about the only place they could eat together. They ordered and sat down, and Mr. Prince said he was selling the orchard, the old cannery, and a little cottage he owned in town for whatever was in Lee's billfold right that moment.
Can you imagine?
Mr. Prince died not too long after. Most of my growing up, folks still thought Lee wasn't nothing but the orchard manager. Would have got to a certain kind of person, not him. Not to Lee Malone.
Janie Treeborne come to own the peach orchard and the other properties once belonging to Mr. Prince, the same way as Lee Malone. She sat at a greasy tabletop inside Woodrow's Pit Cook Barbecue, where, years before, Lee'd counted out of his billfold $2.05 and a receipt for a bag of dog food. And she searched for what money she had in the depths of a purse she felt foolish toting around. Lee's heart was weak by then. He had considered turning the land over to Janie for a long, long time. She thought she would have handed everything down to her visitor, this young man sitting with a tape recorder on his lap and a long microphone gripped in his hand. So why'd she not? Janie couldn't remember. Did it matter? He was here. He was home. Had her same big forehead and freckled nose, her granddaddy Hugh's thick black hair and high-cut cheeks. A Treeborne, she thought, through and through, right down to the bone.
Do you remember how much it was you paid?
He asked.
Foot, yes I do, she said. You reckon your grandma would up and forget something like that? It was $16 and a pack of chewing gum.
Did you ever regret not paying him more?
Regret, foot, she said.
No amount would have been sufficient. This place was priceless. But how to explain that?
Lee's body might have blunted, she went on.
But his mind stayed sharp till the end.
I always tell that if mine ain't, then somebody please shove a gun right here and fire that sucker twice. There's one right yonder in the dresser drawer. I don't give a rip if it sounds morbid. Life's morbid. Love sure enough is.
Lee Malone taught me everything about the peach growing business. Everything. Even helped run the fruit stand through his last good summer on earth. Could still sing his head off, too.
Them trees yonder, we planted them together. Look out that-a-way, you'll see where the house he died in once stood. Wasn't much to the place itself, but it was in Alberta and belonged to him, And there was a time that meant something. See? Other side of the road there. Just below the water tower Ricky Birdsong fell off of.
Are there any pictures of Mr. Malone? The young man asked.
Janie got up from her recliner chair and took one of the dozens of photo albums shelved in the living room and stacked in cardboard boxes pushed against the wall. She opened to a picture of the old Alberta water tower, pointed, turned the page.
Black and whites of folks standing by water, with dogs, by log houses and wood piles, next to pickup trucks and wagons, at school, at church, in decorated cemeteries, along fence lines and unidentifiable roadsides and hedgerows. Somehow, not one picture of Lee Malone.
She turned the page again and pointed at a girl with straight black hair touching bony shoulders.
There's me, she said, squinting as if to be sure. Would have been the year before Mama May died, if I'm right.
Do you still think about it? The young man asked.
She closed the album.
I try to keep a routine for the sake of my mind, but there's only so much you can do now.
Janie Treeborne first received a notice from the authority, say, 3 years ago. Plenty warning. The Hernando de Soto Dam had served its purpose for nearly 80 years. Her granddaddy, Hugh Treeborne, helped build it. Her daddy, Ren Treeborne, an engineer. Janie understood that if the authority didn't implode the dam, then its concrete would give to time and further neglect. A disaster would sure enough occur. The notice claimed there'd be payment for her property, relocation services, the works. Miss Treeborne, the letter called her, just needed to fill out the accompanying forms and mail them back. Janie knew how this story went. She took the notice and she deposited it right in the trash.
The fence post sure does miss its big talkers and bullshitters, she said. I still hear their voices rattling around and around. Air here's always been full of voices to my mind. Pedro agrees, and he abets with the daily dose of radio. Lets them dogs that's always running around sleep inside the station if it's cold or raining. When one comes up lame, he feeds them scraps. But hellfire, I do too when they roam up here. John D. used to say one was going to give me rabies. Foot. I told you, Pedro started reading out our names on the air. A roll call, I reckon. Lucky that us 14 remaining can dial him in another day yet. For that much, we're blessed.
Pedro and me share a sense of humor. Laugh to keep from tears. The young man wanted to know how Janie spent her days, what it was like living in Alberta now, and what all she did.
Sometimes, after breakfast, I'll drive out at the 7 and prowl around them woods for a spell. Same way me and Crusoe did. You'll have to go by there. A Treeborne ain't lived on them 700 acres since Aunt Tammy moved here with me. Used to, though. The highway'd be backed up nearly all the way into town with folks come to see what all Granddaddy Hugh, be your great-great, what all he painted and assembled and left out yonder in them woods. I still call it the 7 instead of whatever the hell they named it. Some of them folks who ran the place treated me like I ought to be put on display alongside them things he made. Art, not things. That word's always got away from me. Time, they wanted me to give a series of talks on it, on him. This was back in the 7's heyday, 80s, early 90s, when some loud, awful band put Granddaddy Hugh's art on their record cover. Sold 1 million copies, they tell. Told them I was too busy to give talks, which was no more than part truth.
Janie eased back down in her recliner. She fixed the hem of her gown over her liver-spotted legs, then patted the arm of the chair 2 times.
I'll tell you, she went on. It's fools who claim the ones you're expecting to go ain't so bad as those you don't. Treeborns never have been long-lived, though. Aunt Tammy lasted longest of her siblings. Daddy was the oldest, Uncle Luther, then her. I can't speak for the long-livedness of Malone's, but Lee dying was bad on me, buddy. And me in my 20s when it happened. Not bad like Mama May, but bad. I was just a fool girl when she died. Like to have ruined us all.
Janie turned her head to better see the young man, gazing as if she'd only then recalled he was in the room. Blinded on one side most of her life, the damaged eye looked like the inside of a grape. The young man was growing used to it, though when Janie leaned forward and clasped his hand, he startled.
There ain't a thing I'd trade, she said. They tried and they tried and they tried to get me to. Some of our own kin, the government, authority, different buddies over the years. John D. Cruz among them. Says he's through begging me. Ain't heard from him in, I reckon, more than a month. Wouldn't trade calling this land home, not even to get my eye back. Shit fire. You could say, Janie, we come up with a way to stop all that lake water from spilling down into the valley. The peach pit can stay open for all eternity, but you gotta move off from here. No, sir. Me in this place? And I don't just mean what you can look out yonder and lay eyes upon. Me in this place is just too tangled up. But I reckon you know that, don't you? Coming up here with a tape recorder to get old buzzard's stories. Days Her Missing, 1958. Wooten Ragsdale had always been afraid she'd leave. Not just him, but this entire place. Tammy'd threatened to since the night she saw her first movie at the Alberta Rampatorium. 14, sitting on a grassy terrace next to a senior named Bobby Davis. Oh, my Lord, she said after the closing credits.
What is it?
Bobby had dozed off when he realized she wasn't game to fool around.
I gotta go to Hollywood, Tammy said.
Hell, right now?
No, you fool. But one day, you watch. I'll be gone.
This realization occurred before Wooten knew Tammy, before the Ragsdales moved to the valley and he ruined his right hand at work. Tammy was, he thought after they met, more than pretty enough to be on the big screen. A face he could cup in his one good hand, bright green eyes, thick black hair, and a good-sized chest. If a Treeborne ever went for Miss Alberta Peach, though none ever did, Wooten liked to brag that it would have been Tammy. After she graduated school, she'd moved down to the Gulf of Mexico. Not quite Hollywood, but still. Wooten was 2 years behind Tammy at Alberta County High. He remembered hearing she'd moved away. But they ran with different crowds, and it didn't much register with him busy playing football for the Conquistadors and working at his Daddy Leland's chicken houses. About a year later, Tammy moved back and started working for the county water department. Everybody figured her adventure to the Gulf Coast would have satisfied her Hollywood dreams. But Tammy kept making threats, even after she and Wooten began dating. It was cute, he thought, at first. But as she aged, and their relationship did too, the threats wore on him. The way Tammy acted was kin to being a grown woman who still pops and plays with her chewing gum. I'll leave this goddamn place tomorrow, she'd say. Wooten didn't know how to handle her outbursts. He was nervous by nature. Sometimes he wanted to just yell back, well, go on then. One night, a few years into their marriage, Tammy, ranting and raving about going to Hollywood and becoming a movie star, Wooten dragged a hard blue plastic suitcase out from the closet and began frantically stuffing it with clothes from their shared chest of drawers.
What on earth do you think you're doing? She asked.
If leaving's what you want, then come on, let's go.
He was a man without much past anyway. Why not up and leave? She stood there watching him for a moment, wondering, could they actually leave together? Then said,
no, stop it, Woot. If I'm going, it's got to be by myself.
Despite Tammy saying this, and the next 4 years of regular threats, Wooten Ragsdale did not decide till the second night of her missing that Tammy'd finally made good on her promise and gone. He was sitting in a recliner chair eating fried pork skins from a brown paper bag while the new television bled blue light throughout the living room of their new single-wide trailer. The embarrassing realization landed on Wooten from above, like bird droppings. His wife had gone to Hollywood, California, and left him here all by himself. He finished the bag of pork skins, then, knowing not what else to do, got in the new used pickup truck he'd bought from Big Connie Ward and drove out into the county. The pickup was a beautiful thing, with wood running boards and white capital lettering across the tailgate. Wooten drove and he drove, trying to believe he'd catch up to his wife if he just kept on. Pull over and she'd hop in, drive back into town and eat a hamburger all the way,
large fry, split a chocolate milkshake with whipped cream. The summer air, all thick and buggy, they'd get in bed and talk about the house they were building on Tammy's folks' land till one fell asleep in the other's arms. Be like one of those damn movies she was always dragging him to see at the Grand 2, ever since the Rampatorium shut down. Tammy had been furious when this happened. She believed there was no better way to see a movie than outdoors, underneath the stars. She'd watch anything. Westerns, love stories, murder mysteries, even kiddie cartoons if that's all that was playing. She said it felt like her innards were being squeezed by the moving pictures and the light. Something important happening. She told Wooten how, when she was a girl, she used to take frames that the projectionist threw out and bring them home, where she held them to lamplight and made up stories for the people and places she saw. Wooten and Tammy did not fool around during movies, the way other couples did. This embarrassed him, too. Folks sometimes called the Rampatorium a passion pit. He just knew everybody noticed his and Tammy's public display of celibacy. On occasion, he tried to kiss.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.